Hello everyone. My name is Shraddha Singh Gautam and I am speaking on behalf of Koshika as a head lab operations. Today I am going to talk about primary cells, as in why they are important in today's world of technology. As all of us are aware that today's world is dominated by pandemics, vaccines, antibodies, etc. So we certainly primary cells have important role in the biotechnology today. So today we'll take a look at what are the primary cells and what are the risk possibilities that we share while working with the primary cells. What are the challenges or complications that we may face while working with the primary cells? And we will also discuss about the modern tools and solutions that we may utilize for isolating different types of primary cells from different sources. Finally, I am going to talk about Koshika, what exactly we are dealing with and what type of primary cells we are currently isolating and what procedures we are following to give you one of the best sources of primary cells. So when we talk about the primary cells, two basic questions pop up in our mind what exactly are the primary cells. So some of you might get confused with the primary cells and the cell lines. So here I would like to add that the primary cells are the cells that are directly isolated from different tissues of human, animal or plant origin. And cell lines are the continuous cell lines that are already isolated and that go beyond fixed passages. So this is the basic difference between the primary cells. These cells are directly isolated from the tissues and cell lines are isolated. They are actually secondary cell lines. They are isolated from the tissues and they are grown for the finite number of times to become a continuous cell line. So these cells are the exact mimic of the organism because they retain all the physiological and biotechnological properties of the organism. They also are the true representative of the genetic makeup of an organism. So why are they important in today's world? So as we all of us are aware that the animal experiments are banned by certain regulatory authorities. So these primary cells can be used for drug screening and toxicity analysis while development of vaccines or any suitable drug. For suitable for human use, we can use primary cells as they are the true representative of humans. We can analyze the efficacy of the drug directly on the primary cells. So they can be a good candidate for drug screening and production of different biosimilars, vaccines. They can also be a good substitutes for cell biology and metabolic research. They can also be used in different animal and preclinical studies. Also recently, their role in 3D organ development or tissue engineering is appreciated because we are aware of different scaffolds that are being prepared using primary cells and in order to mimic the in vivo environment outside the human body. So we can actually grow a 3D, three-dimensional tissue in an in vitro setup using these primary cell lines. So with the increasing usage, we also need to understand the biosafety concerns these primary cells may develop with respect to human health as well as health to the as well as the risk to the environment. And it is essential to assess the risk. Essential to assess the risk through which we may implement containment measures and work practices in order to provide maximum protection to human health and environment. So how to assess the risk? So there are multiple ways through which we can assess the risk. The first parameter is intrinsic properties of the cell culture. So what are the intrinsic properties of the cell culture? The source or the species of the origin. See, as we all of us are aware that the closer the genetic relationship of the cell culture to human, the higher the risk to human. So if we are working with pathogens or influenza virus or viruses, cell lines pertaining to SARS or COVID viruses, we should be aware that some contaminating organism might cross the species barrier and can be fatal to us. So as a matter of fact, there is an increasing order of risk when we use avian or invertebrate cells, other mammal cells like primate cells or human cell lines. If we are using non-human cell lines also, we have to be cautious while working with the cell lines because they may cross species-specific barriers and may be hazardous to us. The second parameter that we should be considerate is cell types or tissue that we are working with. So if in case we are, let's say we are working with the tumor cells or tumor cell lines, then we need to be very cautious because the tumor cells can induce potential risk of production of tumors in us. So we have to be very particular while handling cells like epithelial or fibrillar cells, gut mucosa, endothelium, neural tissues, hematopoietic cells, etc. The risk can also be assessed on the basis of culture type. So whether we are handling continuous cell lines, whether we are handling tumor-specific cell lines or primary cell lines of different tissue origins, we need to be cautious about the risk assessment, that risk that we may face. The second parameter on the, for the risk assessment is on the basis of genetic properties acquired by the cell on the basis of genetic manipulation. So one of the classic example of this is induced pluripotent stem cells. See, induced pluripotent stem cell is produced by the genetic modification of adult progenitor cells with the help of embryonic stem cells. So previously it is believed that embryonic stem cells can induce tumorigenic properties in humans. So in order to prevent that, scientists or researchers recently developed induced pluripotent stem cells. So induced pluripotent stem cells, now there are researchers who have also raised concerns over tumorigenic potential of induced pluripotent stem cells. So that is the reason the risk assessment is important. So risk assessment can be on the basis of if we are introducing any recombinant cells or genetic, if we are having any genetic modification in our cell lines, that may induce a risk to the operator. So host cells are very important to know. You need to understand the characteristic properties of the host cells before working on them. You also need to understand what impact it may have on the donor organism or operator. See, if we are dealing with any non-primate cells, they may have hazardous impact on the donor organism. You should also consider the location through which the genetic manipulation is introduced. And largely, if you are using any vector for dealing with the primary cells, then you need to understand the characteristic of the vector so that you should be able to assess the risk after using it. Lastly, risk assessment should be done on the basis of the pathogenic result of pathogenic agent that you may use. See, some cells are deliberately infected with a pathogen. So in that case, the determination of potential hazard related to the infected cell culture is required. So an examination of inherent properties of infecting pathogen is bacteria or fungi. If you are dealing with bacteria or fungi, they are potential of introducing a contamination in your body as well. So some bacterial and fungal infection are, although they are very easy to prevent, you should be able to assess the risk associated with the fungal or bacterial infection. If you are dealing with a mycoplasma, so compared to bacterial or fungal infection, contamination with mycoplasma can give more problem in terms of incidence. So So it is very difficult to detect the mycoplasma contamination. And even if you are able to detect the mycoplasma contamination, it is more still difficult to eradicate the contamination completely from your cell culture. So as a matter of fact, mycoplasma infection may go undetected for many passages, and this can have detrimental effect on the host cell. So you need to assess the risk of the mycoplasma, like risk while culturing the stem cell, culturing any primary cells. Viruses, if you are dealing with any virus contamination requires a particular attention, because there are some viruses which cannot have any cytopathic effect on the primary cells, and they may go unnoticed. And if you are working with these viruses, then it is eventually possible that you may the host the operator may get infected with those viruses. Some of the categories in this kind of viral infection are human or non-human primate cultures, such as blood-borne viruses like hepatitis B virus. Hepatitis B virus cannot exhibit any cytopathic effect on the cells that we culture. Even human immunodeficiency virus, HIV. For that matter, even hepatitis C virus does not pose any cytopathic effect and may go unnoticed in the cell culture. So you need to be very careful while dealing with the primary cells. There are certain non-human cell cultures as well that may go without risk, as they may contain viruses with broader host range able to infect humans as well as rodents. And lastly, prions. Although prions are very difficult to get entry into the primary cells, we should understand that they are more difficult to inactivate. So if accidentally they gain entry into the cell cultures, it is very difficult to eradicate prions from the cultures. So this thorough assessment is required for the determination of adequate containment level. So there are certain regulatory authorities that have proposed certain containment level while dealing with the primary cells. So it is very important to deal with those containment level in order to protect us as well as the environment. And next we'll have a look at the possible containment levels that we need to work on. So as a general thumb rule, whenever you are handling animal cell culture, you should be able to adopt precautionary measures that are prescribed by different regulatory authorities. So, and much of these measures basically aim at reducing the risk of contamination and adventitious agent by ensuring protection to both operator as well as cell culture. So what are these containment measures? So this flowchart will offer a schematic guidance for the assignment of appropriate containment level, and is based on but not limited to some of the key features of risk assessment that we have already discussed above. So let's say if we are dealing with the cells of human or primate origin, and if suppose they are free of pathogen, then there is actually no risk to the operator as well as the host. So in that case, we can work in the biosafety cabinet 1, which only protects the operator and the environment. Biosafety cabinet 2 is assigned to protect the operator as well as the environment. The use of biosafety cabinet class 2 aims at protecting the operator and the environment as well as the cell culture that you are dealing with. So it is important in order to prevent contamination of cell culture. So if you want a contamination-free cell culture, it is important for you to work in the biosafety class 2. And if you just want to be protected from the cell culture cell culture risk, you can work in the class 1 biosafety cabinet with a minimum risk. Certain regulatory authorities in this view have proposed that animal cell culture should never be manipulated in the biosafety cabinet with horizontal laminar airflow. See, previously we were using horizontal laminar flow for mostly culture work like media preparation or media changes, but we are not supposed to do any cell culture like primary cell work in the horizontal biosafety cabinet, because it does not protect you from the risk associated with the primary cell culture. what are the steps related to the primary cell isolation? So I am here, I am giving you a general overview of the steps that are involved in isolation of primary cell culture. So whatever tissue we obtain, we are taking care that the all the infectious screening is being done for the tissue. So the tissue is absolutely devoid of any infectious contamination, as we have discussed earlier. Like, we are testing HIV, HBV, human immunodeficiency virus. We are also testing it for HCV virus, syphilis, and rubella infection. Once the tissue is free from these infection, and then only we are processing the tissue in our laboratory. So it is very important to collect the tissue that is free from any infectious agent. So first, the first step in the primary cell isolation is harvesting tissue of interest. So it is, as per regulate, as per authorities, it is very important to get the tissue after informed consent of the donor. Second step of primary cell isolation is processing by enzymatic or explant method. There are two types of techniques that we generally use. First is enzymatic method, and the second one is explant method. So with the enzymatic method, we are using different enzymes that are required for dissociating cell-to-cell contact. And explant is a way from which the cells can directly be isolated through crawling. The regulatory authorities have also proposed that it is mandatory not to use enzymatic method, because enzymes can reduce the receptor sensitivity. And so most of the cells that we are isolating in the facility are with the explant methods. Third is culture in specific media and spaçage. So various cells, different cells are, they are grown in different media, specific media with a different cocktail of growth factors and antibiotics. So what is all about the koshika? Koshika is primarily involved in isolating primary cells from different tissue sources of human animal origin, and we are giving those primary cells as per the demands. Like these cells are subculture at a very low pH and are cryopreserved, and on demand they are revived and sent to the customers. So what factors we are considering while developing primary cells? So all of us, we know that the primary cells are either anchorage dependent or they are non-anchorage dependent, or and are soluble in the media, are suspended in the media. So about the anchorage dependent cell lines, we are either explanting them or using some microcarriers for the expansion of the cells. So in case of endothelial cells, we are using scaffolds or coating material like fibronectin, gelatin, or matrigel. So there are different microcarriers or scaffolds that we have developed to optimize the cell growth and maximum viability. We are keeping the cells at very early pH, because as we have discussed earlier, with a long-term pH, the cells may develop chromosomal aberrations, and hence it is important to keep them at a very low pH. So later on, our customers can grow them at a required pH and use them for their studies. So apart from that, we are also encouraging specific media or extracellular matrix or coated flask that we are using to our customers. So each specific cell is developed with a specific growth environment, so which depends upon the pH of the growth media, glucose concentration, the type of extracellular matrix that we have used while expanding the cells, and also the overall environmental condition. So we are proposing that to our customers that they should get the same environment, they should give the same environment to the cells so that they will be able to grow in a better condition. Because many times this happens that we the customers, they get the cells and they don't grow in their laboratory or facility. So in order to avoid that, we suggest that if they use the same media, growth factors that we are using, they will get a better outcome. Secondly, we are using appropriate combination of antibiotic and antifungal agents in order to keep our cultures contamination free. So we are using basically gentamicin and a combination of other antifungal agents like amphotericin B to keep them contamination free. However, at the same time, we should note that if you are using cells and are exposing them to antibiotic or antifungal agent for a long term, they may reduce the efficiency, growing efficiency, and can turn out to be toxic. So it is important that a very well handling of cells are necessary so that you can reduce the use of antibiotic for their growth. It is important to retain the viability of primary cells after isolation, as most of them undergo the process of senescence. We should know that the primary cells are very short-lived, so they cannot be expanded beyond certain passages. So, and it is also very important to maintain the viability till their usage. So what we are doing is we are keeping them at a very low passages, and we are checking their viability after every stage of expansion. We are also suggesting that for a long-term viability of the cell, excellent cell culture handling skills are important, because while handling or due to mechanical forces, certain mechanical or chemical forces, it is quite possible that your cells may undergo death or apoptotic divisions. So it is important for us to have the optimum growth medium and other environmental conditions like temperature, the mixture of gases that are required for growth of the cells, the pH of the medium, and addition of certain growth factors to keep them in that cell doubling phase, presence of different nutrients that are essential for them to be in that metabolic state. So these are the considerations that we need to have in our mind before practicing primary cell culture. Now, second most important parameters that we should consider is cryopreservation. Like most of our cells, we most of initially most of the cell lines were cryopreserved using a very classical method of 10% DMSO plus media. However, it has been observed that the optimization of cryopreservation protocol suffers from two major challenges. First is unfavorable post-thaw cell viability. So whenever we are sending the cells in the cryopreserved state, many of you might have observed the problem that the post-thaw recovery is very low. And the second concern is the safety, which may be induced by the toxicity of the cryopreservative that we use. So if we are using DMSO, it can turn out to be neurotoxic or can be fatal to your cardiovascular system, or it can also promote respiratory arrest. So in order to minimize that, we have developed different patented technology to transit cells from the advanced cell facility to Koshika facility to different institutions wherein these primary cultures can be used. So what we are using is hydrogel based encapsulation technology. Apart from that, there are multiple other techniques as well, like droplet based cell printing, nano warming, trihalose delivery, etc. So what are these technologies all about? So if we are shipping the cells at a remote location, it is important to maintain their viability. So what we are doing is we are encapsulating the primary cells in a hydrogel based capsules, and we are shipping them at a room temperature. So the moment they are shipped and the moment they are received, you can just centrifuge them and isolate the cells with the highest recovery. So there are certain various studies have promoted these technologies. So hydrogel based cell encapsulation techniques are intended to reduce the cytotoxicity and increase cellular viability even after recovery. So these hydrogel based cells can also provide suitable 3D microenvironment to the cells and promote extracellular matrix. They block the immunogenicity of the encapsulated cells. So cells cannot differentiate or divide when they are encapsulated in the hydrogel. And this can greatly influence the final outcome of the outcome post recovery. So this is the technology that we are offering currently. Secondly, I would like to add here that there are currently many players who are dealing with the primary cells. But as I have already discussed, it is important for you to consider the genetic manipulation while dealing with the primary cells. So if you are dealing, like if you want to assess the cells for the drug screening or screening of the biosimilars or animal testing, then it is very important to use cells that are isolated from the tissues of Indian origin, because they will be having the same genetic makeup as we require for the development of drug that is required for the Indian scenario. So that is the reason we are promoting Koshika, because we are getting tissues from a biobank, and these tissues are collected from the sources that are Asian origin, and hence they can be authenticated very well. So we can test this. We are testing the cells for mycoplasma and fungal contamination before dispatch. So this is reduced the risk, as we have already discussed. Each cell that we are isolating is of pure population, because if we are separating the cells for particular antibody by magnetic sorting method, and then we are expanding the cells to get the pure population. The cells are highly characterized, and the cells are, as I already discussed, the cells are grown in a specific media. The shipping methods that we have developed are on user demand basis. Like if somebody wants live cells, we can ship the cells in the flask. If someone wants cells in their frozen form, we have different technologies to ship the cells with a maximum recovery. We can provide cell count and authentication certificate along with each delivery. So the future scope of the primary cells is that we are now being explored for research in 3D system for translational applications, and in order to develop better study model. Thank you so much. So there's one question, that how to procure cell lines from you and what is the charge for cell lines. So procurement is easy. We have provided you with a contact details. You can contact or email us and we'll get back to you at the earliest. The second question is that generally you get the mixed population when you isolate cell from tissue. How do you make sure we get the pure population of desired cells? So as I already discussed, we are sorting each cell with the help of magnetic sorter to get the pure population. So yeah, it is true that we get the mixed population of cell when we first isolate cell from a primary tissue. But then after magnetic sorting, it is we are making sure that the population that we are offering you is pure population with a specificity to particular antibody. So I guess there are no more questions. So we are ending our session here. If you still have any questions or doubt, then you can just contact us through email or the contact number provided, and we'll get back to you with all your queries sorted. Thank you so much.